Welcome to a wonderful Trinity Lutheran Church in scenic downtown Brattleboro, and welcome to those of you who follow on the through the internet and through Facebook. We gather to give thanks to God. That is what worship is. Worship is an act of giving thanks and praise to God. And we gather to learn from the teachings of Jesus. Jesus who guides us to the way of life. Jesus who guides us to truth. We are in the midst of the Lenten season. This is the second Sunday in Lent. And Lent is really a time of preparation for Easter. But it is also a time when we turn again to God. We return to God. And we acknowledge that our inclinations are not necessarily to follow God, but it's to do our own thing. So Lent is a turning. It's repentance, and repentance means to turn around. It's to turn from my way and to follow God's way. And we're going to get there this morning. The readings this morning are really powerful readings, so we're going to get to that in a second. This morning, Laura, our regular organist and choir director, is ill, so Marsha was gracious and said that she would fill in for her. And in our prayers, we shall remember Jeanette Smuts, who is quite ill, and we shall remember Ken and Diane Hill at the death of their son last week. John died, I think he was in his early 60s. Very sad. It was right at his retirement. And we shall be praying for Gunter Garvey. I saw him on Thursday, and he had declined quite a bit. He has been in hospice care. And his wife, Elsie, called me last night, and he has declined much more. And it does not look like he will be with us on this earth very much longer. So we pray that he has a peaceful journey to be with God in God's heaven. I will be with them this afternoon to commend him to God's care. We shall remember those people in our prayers. We shall also remember Annie Bomick in our prayers. She is at the Bradley House. It's a nursing home. And Annie was, I saw her, and she was really chipper the other day. So that's good news. So we shall remember Annie as well. We shall prepare for worship with our confession. And within our confession, we have a time for silence. It's a time for silent meditation. I encourage you to use those moments to release the tensions, the stresses that we hold within us, and to, as we release those tensions and stresses, to breathe in a new breath of God's peace and to rest in God's love for us. Let us prepare. Let us pray. Most merciful God, we confess that we are captive to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart, and we have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Let us pray. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, that we may follow your call and walk in your truth, to the glory of your holy name. Amen.
Amen.
The word of God, the word of Jesus to us, is a word that we are loved by God. That we are God's creation, that God embraces us, that God accepts us. And the promise of God through Jesus is that God is with us always. It's one of my privileges to proclaim the entire forgiveness of all of our sins. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Amen.
I invite you to stand for our opening hymn, which is, "We're Across the Crowded Ways of Life." We'll sing the first four verses. Grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
In peace, let us pray to the Lord. For the peace from above, and for our salvation, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the peace of the whole world, for the well-being of the Church of God, and for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For this holy house, and for all who offer here their worship and praise, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Help, save, comfort, and defend us, gracious Lord.
Amen.
Let us pray together. O Lord, we are in the grip of warfare and destruction, and we who gather under your wings mourn the ways of the world. Save us from a crippling depression of spirit. Save us from escapism. Save us from seeking distraction. Be our help. Inspire us to make a difference to the people with whom we live. Inspire us to cherish the gifts we have received. Move us to live in a way that shows our gratitude for the blessings we have. Through your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. You may be seated.
Today's psalm is Psalm 27. The Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is the stronghold of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid?
One thing I ask from the Lord, this only do I seek,
that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life.
When the wicked advance against me to devour me, it is my enemies and my foes who will stumble and fall.
One thing I ask from the Lord, this only do I seek, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life.
Though an army besiege me, my heart will not fear. Though war break out against me, even then I will be confident.
One thing I ask from the Lord, this only do I seek, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life.
For in the day of trouble, God will keep me safe. God will hide me in the shelter of God's sacred tent and set me high upon a rock.
One thing I ask from the Lord, this only do I seek, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life.
My heart says of you, seek God's face. Your face, Lord, I will seek. Do not hide your face from me. Do not turn your servant away in anger. You have been my helper.
One thing I ask from the Lord, this only do I seek, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life.
Wait for the Lord. Be strong and take heart and wait for the Lord.
Our first reading is a gospel reading, and it comes from the 23rd chapter of the Gospel of Luke. And this reading, this moment takes place when Jesus was being taken to the cross to be crucified. As the soldiers led Jesus away, they seized Simon, who was on his way in from the country, and they put the cross on him and made him carry it behind Jesus. A large number of people followed him, including women who mourned and wailed for him. Jesus turned and said, "Daughters of Jerusalem, do not weep for me. Weep for yourselves and for your children." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
According to Luke chapter 4.
Glory to you, O Lord.
At that time, some Pharisees came to Jesus, and they said to him, "Leave this place and go somewhere else. Herod wants to kill you." Jesus replied, "Go tell that fox, I will keep on driving out demons and healing people today and tomorrow, and on the third day I will reach my goal. In any case, I must press on today and tomorrow and the next day, for surely no prophet can die outside Jerusalem. Jerusalem, Jerusalem. You who kill the prophets and stone those sent to you. How often I have longed to gather your children together as a hen gathers her chicks under her wings, and you were not willing. Look, your house is left to you desolate. I tell you, you will not see me again until you say, 'Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord.'" The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
You may be seated. Grace and peace be unto you from God, our Creator, and from our Savior, Jesus Christ. May the church say amen.
Amen.
We're going to deal with a number of things this morning, and the operative passages are the words of Jesus when Jesus says to the women, he says, weep. But what did he say after that? Weep for who?
Yourself.
Weep for yourselves. Don't weep for me. Weep for yourselves. We're going to combine that passage with the gospel reading where Jesus said, you know, God is like a hen that wants to gather the
chicks
under her
wing,
but the chicks don't want to. So we're going to look at those two passages. And I'm going to begin with a really kind of a Lenten theme. Lent is a time of mourning. It's a time of sadness. It's a time of darkness. The color of Lent is purple. It's a color of mourning and darkness. One of the things that struck me this week are the ways in which we're killing ourselves. Think about this for a moment. We have a problem with climate control. We all know this. And we all know what the repercussions are in the long term. Yet we seemingly can't get countries together to enact policies and rules to reverse the problems that we're creating. We're sowing the seeds for our own doom in the long case. And I hear these words of Jesus. God is like a hen that would gather the chicks together under her wings. Weep. Weep for your ways. With all that's taking place internationally right now, I kind of am curious how many people are aware of the school shooting that took place this week. Sue, is there anybody else? There was a school shooting out in Iowa. A number of young kids were killed. And what struck me about the school shooting is that we've become so accustomed to school shootings that they're almost part of the normal fare of every week or every month. We hear about mass shootings all the time. And they don't seem to have the same kind of effect on us as they used to. They're just part of life. And what strikes me is with the shootings that we see, not just the shootings, does anyone have any idea how many suicides there are per year because of guns? Anyone want to take a guess at that?
Too
just
many.
In America.
Too many.
23,000. 23,000 people take their lives every year in America with guns. I think about that, and whenever we have a school shooting, there's this uproar, we have to have better gun control, yet nothing takes place. Nothing takes place. We're killing ourselves. And what strikes me is I remember reading an article a long time ago. It was a man who tried to end his life. He had severe mental issues. Tried to end his life by jumping off the Golden Gate Bridge, which is a site that many people go to. And he said that, and he survived, but he said that when he let go of the railing on the way down, he thought to himself, another stupid thing I've done. And I wonder of those 23,000 people, how many might have the same reaction. But we can't seem to do anything about it. We can't seem to get into agreement about it. And I hear those words of Jesus again. Weep, don't weep for me. Weep for yourselves. And the human tragedy is really what it amounts to. Climate control, gun control issues. This week, we heard about Purdue Pharmaceuticals. Do you know about Purdue Pharmaceuticals that developed the opioids that they said would not be addictive, and they ended up selling and marketing the opioids not addictive, but they understood at some level they probably were addictive. how many people, I know personally people that were given these drugs at the end of surgery for pain control and who ended up addicted to these drugs. Their lives are torn apart by this. How many hundreds of thousands of people are subject to this? And I hear the words of Jesus. Don't weep for me. Weep for yourselves and the human tragedy. Would God would gather us all under God's wings, but we insist at some level going our own way. So we deal with it with climate control. We deal with it with a gun control. We deal with it with the opioid crisis. We're going to get to the Ukraine in a moment. I think as well about, and we're all, I think you all understand this, I think as well about the issue of the virus when the virus took place. I was fortunate to be exposed to doctors and other people who knew a lot about the virus. I did a lot of research on my own. But what struck me were the number of people who, despite this truth, now what is God? God would have us live in truth. As a hen would gather the chicks under her wings, God would have us live in truth. So what struck me is the number of people who were defiant. Defiant. In face of the truth, defiant. No one's going to tell me what to do. I'm going to go out to dinner. I'm going to do what I want to do. And the words of Jesus stand out. Weep. Don't weep for me. Weep for yourselves. Not only the number of people who are defiant in the face of this truth, but the number of people who would deny it. Oh, everything's going to be fine. This is nothing. We're just going to keep on going on the way in which we've always gone on. In the words of Jesus, weep. Don't weep for me. Weep for yourselves. And when we think about those people for a moment, I mean, this is going to sound a little bit facetious and there's a little bite to it because I'm angry about it. But I think to myself, the people who would be defiant, or the people who would deny the dangers that we were dealing with at that time, three things happened. They either died, got sick and recovered, or they got lucky. But we all read those accounts of people who ill from the hospital relayed, get the vaccine, I made a mistake. And the words of Jesus ring out, weep for yourselves, don't weep for me. That passage that we just read speaks to us. God is like the hen who would gather all the chicks under God's wings, but the chicks don't want to be gathered. Now, I'm going to use the virus situation as a jumping off point. In the midst of the virus, my counsel to as pastor was to look at the blessings of our day, to look at the goodness of our day, and to live in gratitude for the goodness of our day. Because in the midst of that fear, we are gripped with a lot of anger and anxiety. And you have to ask yourself this question. When I'm in the midst of anger and anxiety, how much do I have in my cup to give to other people? The anger and the anxiety that we live with drains us. We still do good things and kind things for others, but our potential is nowhere near what it would be if we were at peace under the wings of God. So my counsel was, in the midst of all of this tragedy, in the midst of all the anxiety and the worry which gripped all of us, can I move myself under the wings of God to live with gratitude for the blessings of my day and the blessings of my life? When I can live with a measure of that peace, then I have more in my cup to give to others. But when I'm living with a lot of anger and with a lot of anger, no, this is nothing. Anger, no one's going to tell me what to do. Anxiety, what's going to happen next? When I'm living in all of that anxiety and anger, well, over here, I have a lot more to give. Over here, I still give, but it's harder. So now we deal with the Ukraine crisis, and I think there is a sense over here again of helplessness and hopelessness. What can I do? And one of the things that I want to emphasize is that we are all helping in the Ukraine crisis. We are all involved. Every time we fill up our car with gasoline, we are contributing to help the people of the Ukraine. Because gas prices have gone up because of this crisis. We all know this. Not only are gas prices going up, but all of the other prices that we're going to pay are going to go way up. Because as gas prices go up, airplane prices are going to go up. Because it's going to cost more to fuel up the airplanes. As gas prices go up, all the goods that are transported by trucks, it's going to cost more to transport them. So we're going to pay a price, and that is our support for the people of the Ukraine. And we all should realize that. We're involved and we're supportive. Some people can help out through contributions to relief agencies, and people are in a position to do that. In the back of the church, you'll see a list of those agencies. The Lutheran churches there are very involved in providing relief. But there are limits as to exactly how much we can do. It's important to realize that we are involved and we are doing. So then how might I move from this anxiety and this anger over this? Because this isn't my plan, this isn't your plan, this is nobody's plan. This has messed up everybody's lives and everybody's dreams and everybody's hopes. And it's easy then to be in the grips of anxiety and the grips of anger about it. Excuse me. And then it's easy to become captive to the latest information that we might read. And I would suggest to you that when we maintain that captivity, stay informed. This is not a call to be an ostrich, completely uninformed. But as we stay captive to these things, we're going to learn about more and more tragedies, more and more gruesome things. No war is played by the rules. There's no such thing as a clean war. We will read more and more about it, and what's that going to do? It's going to ramp up the anxiety level, ramp up the anger level. It's going to drain the cup that much more. So we can stay informed. We're all going to be dealing with those emotional issues. Can we heed these words of Jesus and say, okay, can I look at the goodness of my day, the goodness of my life, and actually give thanks to God for the blessings that I live in? That is very difficult to do in the midst of this. It's very difficult to do. It is not our natural inclination. It takes an enormous amount of discipline to say, I've seen enough, I've heard enough. I've got to look at the goodness in my life. I want to bring myself under the wings of God. When we stay in this place, those words of Jesus, they ring out, don't weep for me, weep for yourselves. Because we stay captive to it and it wrecks us. We do what we can. We understand the support we are providing. And then this move for us spiritually, it's the Lenten move. I want to bring myself under the wings of God to look at the blessings of my day to give thanks for them. What does that do? It fills my cup, which makes me in a better position to be able to give to the people around us. Now, specifically, what I'm going to suggest is in the midst of all the stuff that we're going through as a society, our theme in the Lenten season is to climb your individual mountain. This is stuff we can do. We filled out these cards last week. This is stuff we can do. We ask God for strength. Lord, help me climb that mountain. These are cards we filled out last week. This is the mountain I'm going to seek to climb during the Lenten season so that come Easter, the glory of God might shine through me. Every day I say, Lord God, give me strength to tend to the mountain before me. Remember, in the story of the Transfiguration, Jesus was transformed. The glory of God shined through him on top of the mountain, but he had to climb the mountain. These are the mountains we have sought to climb. We're going to do what we can, but I don't want to be captive to it, which is really the easy thing to happen right now. So I want to move from that place, put myself under the wings of God, seek God's strength to climb this mountain, and to give thanks to God for the goodness of my life. That's our Lenten movement. And I pray that God is a strength for each of us as we get to the Easter mountaintop. Thank you for your attention. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
We're going to sing Cry of My Heart. Our choir is going to sing, so I invite you to come forward to do that.
Longing for hope, many despair.
for shelter, many are homeless. Longing for warmth, many are cold. Make us your building, sheltering others, walls made of living stone. Christ, be our light, shine in our hearts, shine through the darkness. Christ, be our light, shine in our church, gathered today. Servants to one another, signs of your kingdom come. Rise, be our light, shine in our hearts, shine through the darkness. Christ, be our light, shine in the church, gathered today.
Let us affirm our faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
O Lord, we mourn for the people of the Ukraine, for the lives lost, for the land destroyed, for the soldiers fighting, for those whose lives are at risk, for the whole world community. Make us ever mindful of the perils of human sin. May we hold to the good we can do in this time of darkness. Save us from despair and hopelessness. Embolden world leaders and the world community to act with prudence and courage. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
O Lord, open our eyes to our limits and our possibilities. Though we can do little to impact the world darkness, inspire us to climb the mountains that are before us. Save us from excessive anger and despair, that we might see the good in our lives and live with a modicum of peace. For it is out of such peace that kindness will blossom. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We pray for our church, that we be a community of encouragement that celebrates the goodness of our days. We pray, O Lord, you inspire in us the discipline to recognize our limitations and temptations, and to do what we need to do to avoid succumbing to those powers. Lord, in your mercy, we lift up to you the refugees who are settling in this area, and we pray for those who are helping them. May these relationships be a blessing for all. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer. Lord God, we pray for friends and relatives who are journeying in the wilderness of illness and travail. We remember Annie Bomig. We pray for Jeanette Smuts. We remember the Hill family in mourning for John. And this morning, O Lord, we lift up to you especially our brother Gunter Garby, his wife Elsie, and their children. We ask, O Lord, that Gunter see before him a vision of the saints who await him in your kingdom. And we pray, O Lord, that that vision bring him your peace. Lord God, we have burdens that rest on our hearts that we bring to you in the silence. Be the strength, O Lord, of the people in the Ukraine. Especially we remember Alex's family. Into your hands we commend all for whom we pray. We commend ourselves. We commend our family and friends, trusting in your presence through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Amen.
God's peace be with you all.
And also with you.
If you have an offering this morning, we are grateful for it. As we have been doing for the past few months, the offering plate is at the center aisle in the back of the church. Let us join voices together in praying our offertory prayer. If you have a food offering, please bring it forward for the food bank, which we support in Brattleboro. Let us pray together. O Lord, we are blessed and we are grateful. Receive these gifts with our hope that they help our church inspire others to follow your way to life, to celebrate their blessings, and to live with thanksgiving. In Christ's name, amen.
Amen.
We shall distribute communion this morning around the altar. I encourage you to try to maintain spacing as best you can. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
In the night he was betrayed, Jesus took bread and gave thanks. He broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat, this is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup and gave thanks, and he gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Remembering the words that Jesus taught us, we are bold to pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Please come forward.
Of God, you take away the sin of the world.
Nancy, the blood of Christ shed for you. Amen. Chris, the blood of Christ shed for you.
Amen.
Marsha, the blood of Christ shed for you. Amen. John, the blood of Christ shed for you. Amen. Carolyn, the blood of Christ shed for you. Amen. Sue, the blood of Christ shed for you. Sharon, the blood of Christ shed for you.
Please stand if you are able. May the body and the blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen us and keep us in God's peace.
Amen. Amen.
May our Lord bless us and keep us. May our Lord's face shine upon us and be gracious unto us. May our Lord watch over us and lead us on the way to peace. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen. Amen.
Let us join voices in singing, God of grace, God of glory. John and Carolyn are leaving. It's like, break my heart.
Oh.
I mean, this is, throw us into the wanton desert where we are going to be yearning for an oasis, just a cup of water over the next couple of months. When are you going to be coming back?
September.
Take my breath, September. Oh, Lord. First it was the virus, now this. Well, we hope you have a great trip, and we certainly will be remembering you, praying for you, and we hope that everything goes really well for you out there. We have coffee downstairs. Those of you who so choose, we have a little group that meets in the conference room. It's kind of climbing the mountain is our focus. How are you doing in that climb? We had a nice discussion last week. Council meeting right after that. I don't have any other announcements.
Go in peace. Climb the mountain one step at a time. Serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thanks be to God.